In a new study published this week in the journal PLOS Biology, molecular biologists describe something unbelievable: the sequence of the oldest RNA discovered to date. This RNA is estimated to be a little over 14,000 years old. Its very existence challenges the long-held belief that ancient RNA just isn't a thing, and it suggests that there could be lots of RNA waiting to be discovered in ancient remains. Now, 14,000 years might not sound that impressive. After all, a couple years ago, scientists were able to sequence the entire genome of a 700,000-year-old horse. But that was DNA, the molecular blueprint inside of cells. And though DNA starts to break down when a cell dies, under certain circumstances it can be preserved for thousands of years. RNA is thought to be much more temporary, and that is by design. One of its main jobs is to carry the instructions written in DNA to the cell's protein-making factories, a process that ideally is pretty quick. Once those instructions have been delivered, an army of enzymes goes after the RNA to break it down and get it out of the way. And because it's chopped up so quickly, many researchers have long assumed that there's no point in looking for RNA in samples that are hundreds or thousands of years old. Except, recent studies have suggested ancient RNA may exist after all. So the authors of this new study decided to look for it in some exceptionally well-preserved canine remains. Two of their samples were skins from wolves shot in Greenland in the 1800s and 1900s. The third was a sample of tissue from a, quote, puppy found in frozen Siberian soil, which was carbon dated to around 14,000 years old. And amazingly, the researchers were able to find and determine the sequences of RNAs from all three specimens. They could even tell what type of tissue they sampled based on the RNA. The Siberian sample now has the honor of being the oldest RNA known to science by about 9,000 years, and the oldest sequenced by over 13,000 years. And that's especially exciting because RNA can tell us things that DNA cannot. For example, because it reflects what a cell is doing at a given moment in time, it could reveal what conditions an organism was experiencing when it died, and even hint at the causes of death in cases where there aren't obvious physical traumas. There are also some viruses that lack DNA, like HIV and influenza. These are super significant for modern medicine, so it would be great to see how their sequences have changed over time or identify their presence in an ancient body. But that's basically impossible without ancient RNA, because these viruses often don't leave any other trace in the archaeological record. But it remains to be seen whether RNA is actually all that common. The authors pointed out that this Siberian sample was particularly well preserved, and such remains are very rare. Still, they're hopeful that there's more ancient RNA hidden in the frozen soils of places like Canada, Alaska, and Antarctica. And it doesn't have to come from soft tissues. Bones, keratin, even plant seeds could potentially be untapped reservoirs for millennia-old RNA. Speaking of big surprises from the past, paleontologists announced this week that they've unearthed a giant parrot in New Zealand, the first giant parrot known to science. Today, the biggest parrot in the world is the kakapo, a nocturnal flightless species native to New Zealand. You may have seen this bird having sex with Stephen Fry's cameraman's head. That's why I know it, mostly. They can weigh up to 3 kilograms, which is about twice the weight of the biggest macaw. But that's downright wee compared to the Heracles inexpectatus, the fossil parrot researchers described this week in a paper in the journal Biology Letters. The fossil was found in rocks dated from the early Miocene epoch, between 19 and 16 million years ago. And so far, all researchers have found are the partial remains of 2 leg bones, which is not much to go on. Still, unique features of those bones made it clear that they came from a member of the parrot branch of the bird family tree. And the team was able to calculate weight and height estimates based on the relationship between leg proportions and body size in birds. That math suggests that the bird weighed a colossal 7 kilograms and stood about 1 meter tall. Of course, with just leg bones to work with, it's hard to say much else about this Herculean parrot's daily life. But at that size, it's a safe bet that it was flightless, and it was probably doing the same thing that most most enlarged birds on islands do, taking over unoccupied environmental niches. You see, evolution does weird things in isolation, and one of them is to make small animals big. It's a phenomenon known as insular gigantism. And the fossil record is full of examples of birds that got big on islands. Oversized ducks in Hawaii, giant storks in Indonesia, and the dodos of Mauritius, just to name a few. But New Zealand really takes the cake for big bird diversity. It's been home to giant geese, humongous eagles, and the famous moas, in addition to the world's biggest parrots. These birds were able to achieve such large sizes because the islands were basically devoid of the sizable predators and plant eaters that lived on the mainland. So in the diverse subtropical forest of Miocene New Zealand, there would have been lots of open opportunities for a big bird to take up browsing on vegetation, or perhaps step into other roles normally filled by medium-sized mammals. Some have even speculated that this parrotzilla may have eaten other parrots, but there's no actual evidence of that yet. Truth is, we won't know what they ate or how big they really got until we find more fossils. Such finds could also shed light on the bird's relatives. Researchers aren't sure if Heracles is a close cousin of the kakapo or a separate instance of gigantism in parrots. Either way, these jumbo parrots shake up what we thought we knew about parrot evolution, and hopefully more fossils will help us flesh out this unexpected titan. Thanks for watching this episode of SciShow News, and a special giant thank you to S.R. Foxley, today's president of space. Your continued support of this channel makes a colossal difference. So does the support of all of our patrons, so thanks to all of you. And if you're not a patron, but you think what we do here is good, and you would like to help us do it, you can learn more about that at patreon.com/scishow.